to St. Paul Lutheran Church this morning as we come together to thank and praise God. It would be easy to praise a man, praise Ted today, he's a good man. But to praise God who gave to you family, friends, all the family, so many church members gave us Ted. And he was God's gift to us, a unique person to impact us. And so we celebrate his life and thank and praise God today. As we come together, it's certainly a time to grieve, to express that sadness. And yet, the white cloth that's placed over the casket symbolizes for us the reason for our hope. That through Jesus, through what he did, that is put on us. That is how God sees us, not as we are, but as what Jesus did for us. That's put on us in baptism through faith. And Ted received that. And so there's the cross and the crown, kind of like what's up on the screen, the crown, and that wonderful promise that be faithful unto death, I'll give you the crown of life. That's given, and that's our hope. And that's placed over Ted by God's gift to him today. Well, a few housekeeping details, if you don't mind, because we're in unusual times, right? So thank you for sitting as best as you can, socially distant. Most of the songs that we'll be singing, our music director, Rick Fortney, will announce. Most of those, he will be singing the main verse. And we ask you to just sing the refrain. Now, if you're singing, please keep the mask on. If you happen to be sitting closer than 6 feet to, you know, it's okay for parties and families, not 6 feet, but if you're within that, then keep the mask on. You do it all the time for your safety, for others' safety, okay? All right. So I hope you all received a program, a bulletin, and our order of worship is marked out for us there. And we begin by inviting God and then hearing promises that Scripture has for us. And we'll speak responsibly, P for pastor, C for congregation. That's you, so chime in, okay? So let's begin as we invite God to be with us. Of course, he's everywhere, but we want him to be with us with his promise, with his love, through Christ our Savior. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace and peace to you from God our Father.
And the Lord Jesus Christ.
God's great love for us was revealed in the coming of Jesus to be our Savior.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that everyone who believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
God invites us into a faithful relationship with him through the waters of baptism.
All authority has been given to me.
Joined by sing the last verse with us. If you do not have a mask due to health concerns, I totally get it. But I ask that you just pray for the words and not sing, because there's concern with singing. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise.
The cross, I'm learning gladly buried.
We give thanks for your loving kindness to this your son, Theodore, who, having finished his course in fame, now rests from his labors. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our journey on earth. Now, as you are our refuge and strength, help us to hear the words of faith, dispel our fear, ease our loneliness, and reawaken our faith because of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, our hope, in whose name we pray.
Amen.
Please be seated now.
Thursday morning, just kind of went out for a walk and thinking about the way that Papa had lived his life, what he gave up himself for all the things that he's done for me, all the things he's done for others, and probably most of you sitting here today. So if I could find a couple verses in scripture that would give an example of the life that Papa had lived. What came to mind was Luke chapter 6, verse 37. That came to mind. And it was about giving oneself, never expecting anything in return. And these are the words of Jesus to us. And it's, stop judging, and you will not be judged. Stop condemning, and you will not be condemned. I was getting a lesson as I was reading this again. And that sounds like it's already assumed that we've already done both of those. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. And it goes on, give, and gifts will be given to you, a good measure packed together, shaken down, and overflowing will be poured out in your lap. For the measure with which you measure will in return be measured out to you. To the best of my knowledge, I can't recall a time about never condemning or judging anyone. But maybe most important, forgive and you will be forgiven. And again, this sounds like something that needs to be addressed in order for us to move on to the giving. And the word says give, and that's all it says. It just says give. And Papa had this part figured out. Papa gave, he gave up his time, his talents, he taught us about life, how to provide for our families, how to fix things, how to build things, how to treat others, and how to love without saving wounds. Give, and gifts will be given. So close your eyes for a moment. And listen to his promise again. Give, and gifts will be given to you. A good measure, packed together, shaken down, and overflowing, will be poured out into your lap. For the measure in which you measure will in return be measured out to you. And I think the grandkids will understand this part. I know exactly his response to the gifts he received the moment he got into heaven. This is pouring out in front of him. And he's, Jesus. Stop his response to the left. And second thought, as I was going along with the story of the prodigal son, what I referred to as the forgiving father. So this is a personal story of mine. I remember when I was 15, Dad and I had fixed up the 64th Ford Fairway. Papa laid out this really nice paint job on it. car is working on the garage. I was going to drive my 66 Fairway. I didn't have time to wait to get my license. Well, Dad caught up to me at the high school during the football game. I'm really not sure how to find him yet. But I can tell you, he wasn't happy. I guess it went something like, what are you thinking? And he's definitely, I can use everything I've worked for. He could cause an accident. And he was just, I mean, livid, angry, mad, yelling at what's going on and on and on. Okay, man, I get it. So, and after all this, so let's go home. You can drive. That was a lesson well learned. And I can promise you that it was never ever allowed to give, ever. And to me, this is what forgiveness feels like. And this is how Papa lived. He set a great example for us to follow. And I think today he just taught me another lesson as I was kind of going through all this. That without forgiveness, you can't begin to live. Love, Papa.
Thank you.
today in heaven. After this, John writes, I looked and behold, a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb, who is Jesus, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, Amen, blessing and glory, wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. And one of the elders addressed me, saying, Who are these clothed in white robes, and from where have they come? I said to him, Sir, you know. And he said to me, These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation, like on this earth. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. This is the word of the Lord. Our gospel lesson for today comes from St. John, the 14th chapter, beginning at the first verse. Jesus is the way and the truth and the life. Jesus said, Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Sally asked that we would include Hallelujah by Leonard Cohen in the service.
Sally, I hope it's okay, but I found these words that I changed. And I encourage you to read those words as I sing it. And then every time you get to the refrain of Hallelujah, please join in singing.
I close my eyes.
I yield to him, so Jesus can erase my sin. With his blood he can wash me clean as white as snow. I'll stand upon his promises that when I die, I'll still be his, and together we'll praise him.
Have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger. I will
Father, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found," and they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near the house, he heard music and dancing, and he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he has received him back safe and sound." But he was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him, but he answered his father, "Look, these many years I have served you, and I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, comes home, you killed the fatted calf for him?" And he said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found." Hearing this story Jesus tells, there's a truth that relates to all of us, because all of us are portrayed in this very short, simple story. This man had two sons, and both sons really treat their father terribly. Both sons only wanted to use the father for what money they could get out of him. The younger son, he said, "Give me," and he got it and he turned his back. And he said, "Dad, I want nothing to do with you," and he left. So he takes everything and he goes. And let's be honest, some of us, we've treated God that way. We want the gifts that God gives, but we don't want anything to do with him. We want the money, the blessings, the nice things of life, but we don't want a relationship with God, even though he's the one who gives us every good gift. And we often waste what God gives us because we use it all on making ourselves happy, on our comfort, on our temporary enjoyment. And then there's the older son, and he also is like his younger brother, because what he wants is his father's stuff. But he goes about it in a very different way. He asks his father, "Where's my party? I never disobeyed you." And the older brother thinks, he's been good. He hasn't been the bad boy, but good. Good enough to deserve it. He believes that he can get his father's things by working, performing, earning the goods from his dad. And some of us are like the older brother. We've got our act together. We've done everything right. We've worked hard, and we can look at God, and sometimes we say, "God, you owe me. Look how I've lived. Give me." And then we can look at others and say, you know, in judgment, we look down and we say, "They don't deserve what I deserve because I worked so hard." See, we're all in this story. We either look at God and say, "Give me and leave me alone," or "Give me because I deserve it, I earned it." And regardless, we all want the same thing. We all want the good things of life, but we don't want the giver of that good stuff. We're all prodigals. And yet the father in this story, we have a father, God, who is represented by the Father, who has such love. His love is over the top, lavish, extravagant, freely given. And in that story that you told, Ted had a way that he was like this father, not perfectly, but in a small way, And he loved his family very much. Very giving God. And working hard for all those years to provide for what is a very good family life there on Baumhart. You know, Sally said, when I count 10, I had 5 slaves. She ran the place. And it was a good life, right? It's true. Okay. But I can't think of another man who would give so much that I heard this story that he would say to Sally, well, what mall do you want to go shopping at today? Let's go to Toledo. And he would sit there by the dressing room while she tried on whatever she wanted. And most he asked for was in the days when he smoked was a pack of cigarettes for the day. But very giving, very forgiving. He worked here at St. Paul quite a bit to serve God, serve the people. He was part of the family here, worked as trustee, fixing things. And he was very generous with his time, helping others build things and serving them that way. Now, in Jesus' story, this younger son, he was out and he's eating slop of the pig trough, and he decides that he's going to go home because it would be better for him to be a servant in his father's house than to live as he was. And the son doesn't expect the father to embrace him as a son. He's just hoping the father will have enough mercy to let him live as a slave in that house. So he makes the long journey home. And he doesn't expect the reality that his dad has been waiting and looking from the door each day and looking out the window, waiting for his son to return. And when he sees his son from a long way off, he runs to his son. Now you gotta remember, Middle Eastern sheiks never ran. Even today, important people, you know, have you ever seen Queen Elizabeth run? You never ran. Okay? But he, forgetting all propriety in his love, he runs to his son and embraces him and kisses him in wonderful forgiveness before the son even gets one word out of his own mouth. And it's unexpected. Everyone who heard this story would be shocked. I mean, after what that son did to the father should scold him, punish him, should say, I told you so, but instead, he lavishes his son with love and then throws a feast of a lifetime, and gives him the best robe. So he's welcoming his young son back, not as a hired hand who's going to sleep out in the bunkhouse, as someone who has to work to earn his keep on the family farm. He welcomes him back as a son, giving him a robe, sandals. Servants in those days went barefoot. Son wore sandals. A ring, the family ring, giving him an inheritance. And this is all given by grace. And this is our God. Our God who loves us with a love that we don't deserve and gives us the best of what he has. And the best of what he has is his own son. His son, Jesus Christ. A God of love, but he's also a God of justice because, you see, somebody had to pay the price for bringing the younger son back. Somebody has to pay for the robe and the ring and the fatted calf. And for you and me, that price to bring us back to this God of love is the price of Jesus' life. That he took the punishment. He paid by giving his life for us in our place, and doing that in great love as he went to the cross for us. Today, that's the good news that makes all the difference. Makes all the difference today. Takes us from a place of only despair to having hope. Because without Christ, we would have just grief and just heartache, period. Because of Jesus, we have heartache and comfort. We have heartache and a future, a reunion in heaven that God has won because Jesus paid for it. And Ted believed this. He depended on God's grace like that younger son. And he knew this grace and this forgiveness and this love because the way into the Father's party in heaven is a free gift that's not deserved, not earned, but paid for by another, paid for by Jesus Christ. See, at the end of this story, it's interesting to look. Which son is outside of the party? The younger one, the bad boy, who ended up relying on grace and love, he's in. And the older son, the story ends without telling us how it resolves. Why? Because the older son trusted in what he believed he earned. He trusted in his sense of what he deserved by how he lived. He demanded the goods from the father. Kind of turned his relationship with his father, it should be a loving relationship, turned it into a business transaction. Instead of relying on the father's free and lavish and giving love and forgiveness. And for us, it's time to be honest and ask, well, where am I in this story? Where do I, as I think about God and life, where do I stand before God? Am I embracing his love or older son rejecting his love? It's time for all of us to come home today. And today, God will embrace you. So come to him and he'll meet you wherever you are with his love. And you'll also find he'll be with you with his comfort, comfort that you'll need as you celebrate Ted's first birthday without him, first anniversaries, Christmas, all of those difficult days. God will be with you, and he'll comfort you. That's great. And you see, one day, all of us will die as Ted did, all of us. And I hope that none of us have an appointment with that set, and I hope that we will uplift today, but we just don't know. And when your life, the time comes, when your life will be over, will you know the one who loves you, forgives you, says, come by my grace, welcome into the fire, paid for by me, Jesus Christ. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in faith in him for the rest of you. Sally, you're part of the handbell choir. The handbell choir gathered together. And they are going to share an anthem with you right now. You don't have to go up there and play with them.
Thank you.
Apostles' Creed. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We pray responsibly. Almighty God, grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and that through the gate of death and the grave, we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection.
Amen.
You may be seated for the final song.